Welcome to Black Hat Briefings 2001, held July 11th through the 12th in Las Vegas, Nevada. This is videotape number 35B, the Honey Net Project.
Here. All right. No, we're fine. What we're going to do is we're going to finish up talking about the IRC. On the IRC side, we're going to have Samuel go over it a little bit. He's the one that did the translations when the guys were dropping into Urdu. And then we're going to have Max Kilger maybe talk a little bit about his psychological analysis of it and stuff like that. It's really nice having a psychologist on the team. Be honest, though, I'm not sure if you joined to learn about the Black Hats or just study us. What we're going to do then is we're going to then, once Max and Samuel are done, we're going to shift gears. We're going to kick into the new slide presentation about everything that's coming up in the future. Once we're done with that, this shouldn't take too long. I think what time is it now? It's 4:30 and we're scheduled to go to 6. We're not going to 6. At the most, we'll go to 5:30. Well, the reason for that is we want to wrap up early, so if you guys have any more questions, you can come up and beat up the whole team. Like I said, we're all here and stuff like that. And most of the guys will be at DEF CON, stuff like that, so feel free to beat them up too. Okay, no further ado, I'm going to hand this off to Samuel. Let him go ahead and do his magic.
Greetings. Let me now talk to you about some of the stuff we found on the IRC logs. I'm switching the show. I'm putting in my own show instead of Lance's. Yeah, love to hog the media, but I'm sure I'm going to make these slides public in your part. Telephone alert.
Whoever's ringing, raise their hand.
Shut it off or answer it. Okay, there. With IRC, I mean, the purpose of IRC was twofold. One was for the attackers to control ops on all the boxes that they owned. They had like some few hundred boxes that they had IRC channels on. And every time they run a command like a ping or something, and every bot would respond, every system would echo that command back and start firing things off. The purposes of this became clearer to us later on. But over here I've got snippets of their conversations that we captured from 14 days from then on. On June 4th, they did nothing much but just set up the channel. Set up their nicknames and all. I just have a little screen clip on their nicknames. I've sanitized them to Jack and Jill. Later on, in one of the logs, they discuss they want to build an exploit archive and put up all the stuff on a website, and password protect it and things like that. And they get great kicks out of discussing, password protection schemes. So what we found from these logs, just going to make this clear. From the logs, not only could we find out their motives, but get evidences on their origin. They were residing in Pakistan at that time. From some of the names that they used, we could figure out that, well, this is a Middle Eastern name or this is a Southeast Asian name. We had some conversation logs which gave out their locations, like somebody saying, what's the time in Karachi and things like that. So we figured they were there. A lot of the conversation was in Urdu, but typed with English text. Like you use phonetically constructed words out of English. Urdu is pretty close to Hindi. I'm a native Hindi speaker, so and they didn't know that. So I was translating all the stuff in semi-real time between 12 a.m. and 2 a.m. every day. After I do my day job, I get doing this. So who are these people? These apparently were people belonging to a hacker group called G-Force. This group is still at large. You can see from attrition.org, they keep on defacing sites even today. They were self-styled political soldiers, wanted to liberate Kashmir and things like that, the whole propaganda motives. But in reality, they're Twinkies playing with dangerous tools. I mean, who would use Pico if you know VI is on their system, right? Beg your pardon? Yeah, sure.
The one clearly indicative thing that how we knew that they weren't truly political was when they went on to pound carding to get credit cards so they could register fatchicks.in.
Oh my gosh. Yeah? Fatchicks.co.in or just make probe. Okay. June 6th, they're trying to brag about denial of service attacks that they have launched on some of their systems. And these people were so juvenile that if one of their members irritated another, they'd denial of service their own kind. They start firing ping and smack attacks at them. Yeah. I've got some candy too. Okay. So for all their elite DOS techniques, they couldn't even figure out how to mount their own drive D. So over here, they're saying, yo, tell me how do I mount my drive D? The guy says, let me check. Try mount CD-ROM. I'm saying drive D. Well, okay, try mount MS-DOS dev FD0. No. You know. So you figure out they're fumbling around as they go. Then on June 7th, they try to attack systems in India with a bind NXT exploit. Guy says, scan Indian servers for bind. And one guy says, be very, very quiet. I'm hunting lemurs. And all this stuff is going on in Urdu, and I'm translating it and watching what's going on. June 7th, also, they discussed how it is easy to use Windows for denial of service attacks as opposed to Linux. The last line says, in Urdu, it says, Linux mein banda confused ho jata hai, means in Linux, a person gets confused. Okay? June 8th, they tried to figure out how sniffers work. They couldn't kind of get the idea that you got to be on the same subnet to sniff, So one guy says, where are you sniffing on? Doesn't it have to be the same network? And they're still fumbling around. Okay. They love... enough said. Probably Max can touch up on this. Gives you an idea about their habits and their age. Last line saying, my dad's leaving, time to get high. June 9th, they go to 0 to 40 in 3 hours. They have some script which runs and trojans 40 servers in 3 hours, and they brag about it, and bringing their total up to 107 bots that they own. Yes, Max.
This is one thing you'll find that's real common, is that the community is really a meritocracy. And so your status position in that community is really important. And one way that you can... lands. And how do you determine your position or status in this community? One way, of course, is how many boxes you own. And not just how many you own, but whose do you own is also important. If you own someone's box in someone's bedroom somewhere, who cares? If you own a nice box at NASA or something, that's much, much better.
One more thing, though. Look at that line. I own a Trojan 40 servers in 3 hours. Think about it. We're all sitting here laughing at how incompetent these guys are, and yet these guys are able to do so much damage in so little time. So yes, this tells us, when we watch the IRCs, yes, this tells us a lot about the incompetence of these individuals, but also says something about us in the security community when individuals this incompetent are doing that much damage. Just imagine if they were competent.
Absolutely. One of the training, kind of the corporate training things at stake is when we come in is I give the talk called I Got Me Mad Skills. And that's taken from these IRC logs. And just to totally reinforce Lance's message, it's all fun and games and laughs until someone loses an eye. And the actual, then it becomes a profession, exactly. The bottom total was 305 boxes?
Yeah, it was an ugly number.
Yeah.
That we saw.
And this is from people who can't do tar and don't know how to mount. Okay.
For a while, they own a name server of a major Saudi Arabian country.
What, yes.
Timing is blown. They actually owned a Linux box inside the NOC of in South Korea.
Yeah.
That was great.
Okay.
As they go along in their adventures, they rediscover new things, like the ping of death. They never knew it existed. So one guy says that if you give a simple online command of ping, it'll reboot any Win98 machine. And for the rest of the day, they get their kicks in just doing that, and being very happy about it. June 12th, now this is where it gets alarming. They just hack up the whole billing system of an ISP. Incidentally, this ISP was in Pakistan itself. They have the whole billing system, and they brag about it. They get around 5,000 accounts, but they couldn't figure out how to crack them. So one guy is trying to say, where is its password file? And the guy says, oh, try to crack it. Then they figure out that we'll have to unshadow it before cracking it. And they're still trying to fumble around. One guy saying it's still on 0%, and they get upset about it. So they weren't. They had to fumble around as they go. Didn't know basic skills. June the 13th, they turned their attention towards some popular sites in India, one of Indian portals called Namaste India, and also they turned their attention towards White House. Just the mention of this is an official cause for prosecution, and I think at this point we had to call in. We had to call in the law enforcement. Oh yeah, yeah. Right. Yeah. This next slide is the credit card thing. They try to join a channel called Pound Carding, and they start trading credit cards to register domain names for themselves. How clever is that?
What we saw here was happening too. Is this explains a motivation? Why do guys want to hack sites? One of the things they were doing here is they were trading credit cards for accounts to hack systems. So in other words, if you have 50 hack systems, you might be able to get 50 credit cards.
Hey, just a quick point about those credit cards, too. Out of the whole bunch of them, only one was real, and it had already been canceled. So if you're online trading credit card numbers for that stuff, be careful.
We can talk a little bit more about it. You want to go first?
Okay. Yeah. We'll talk a little bit more about the community because it's really very fascinating. Like I said before, there's really it's really a meritocracy, and how do you sort of decide where you are in that status hierarchy? And one of the ways you do it is you meet someone else online, and I have sort of a whole slide that sort of goes through sort of the social dimensions of the community. And one of those dimensions besides status is also derogatory statements. If you look through this IRC chat, you'll see lots of them everywhere. Oh, those guys, they're lamers, they're losers, yada, yada, yada. You're not cool, things like that. And really what they're doing is they're trying to assert their status position. That is, I have this position and you are below me. And then they were talking about another group, and that other group, they were an out-group, and so they were trying to lower their status as well, saying, oh, they're losers, they don't know what they're doing, we're much cooler than they are, we're elite.
I mean, they get really flowery with their bad words. I mean, even I learned some new Hindi bad words that I had, you know.
Must thank you for teaching me the word yar. I spread it throughout the office, and for like days, people were going, yar! There are also a lot of social control processes involved there, because sometimes things don't go like they're planned. For example, when they brought up the one of the individuals, all of a sudden they were talking to the other one and said, oh, well, I'm a Fed. And it was, you could almost hear the conversation screech to a halt. Because not only was that just sort of like scary to them, but it was really a huge sort of breach of protocol. Sort of like, well, I slept with your sister, or something like that. It was. Yeah, well, that probably would have been better than what they said. And that really sort of destroyed the social fabric of the group. And the conversation and the chat never really recovered after that. It really sort of produced a strain. And from the RC chats that I saw, it just like died. And it never really came back to its normal social structure.
All right, what we're going to do now is this. In a minute here, we're going to point you to more information on both Jeff and Max's analysis. What we're going to do here is we're going to shift gears a little bit. What we just finished was actually the first presentation. I was an example of what we've done in the past, how we've gotten the information, and the value of the information. What's really neat about these IRC chats is it really shows you how the inside mind of these guys. You know, that's real research intelligence value. Now we're going to do shift gears, and I've been telling a lot of people ask me questions afterwards. I kept saying, wait to the second part. We're going to show you where we're going. So let's go ahead and jump in there. Like I said, if you have questions, feel free to go ahead, shoot, beat us up, and stuff like that. But once we finish up, we're yours for the rest of the night. Ask questions. Go ahead. All right, let's go ahead and shift gears. Okay, the purpose of this session is to explain the future goals and the activities of the HoneyNet project. What you have just seen is phase one. What we have just talked about was everything up to this point was phase one. 2 years of that research was phase one. And to go ahead and wrap all that stuff up, we've written a book. Why did we write a book? Because we kept getting emails, write a book, all this information is great. So what we've done is we've taken together and we've written a book. The book is based on 2 years of our research. Everything we found, how we figured it out, what we've learned, all that great stuff. For example, in our book, both Jeff and Max go into detailed descriptions of what they found. Jeff goes into specific profiling, how he profiled the guys, what he found when he profiled. Max does a psychological analysis of these guys, which is rather interesting and stuff like that. The book will be coming out in August, so that's one reason. The other reason we're writing a book is this will actually be a source of income for us, funding. We have no money. We're dead broke. We've got a lot of exciting things we're going to cover. This is the funding on it. The book will actually get released next month, and actually we have information here, so... Does the book have a name? Yeah, just pass a big grip at the end. Samuel, he's got this. I think he's got this side. Okay, the name of the book is called Know Your Enemy, because that's the title of our Know Your Enemy series. It's called Revealing the Security Tools, Tactics, and Motives of the Black Hat Community. The author of the book is The Honey Net Project. The money goes to The Honey Net Project. So everybody you see standing up here contributed to the book. And actually here, I think we got the book itself is broken down into three parts. Question. Oh, that's an idea. Yeah. Yeah, they want YAR equals dude t-shirts. The book is actually broken down into three parts. It's what HoneyNet is, its value, how it works, and the risks and issues involved. In other words, it's everything we've done. We got four chapters just on how we build HoneyNets, just so you can answer, how did they get that information? How were they able to do all that? We cover it. Source code, all that good stuff. We have a CD-ROM that has everything. We also show you how to analyze the data. Dave does stuff on forensics. We wanted to write a part on how do you look at snort captures. Well, you had the snort guy write it, stuff like that. So what we did is we had a second part here covering how to do the analysis, how do you figure out that data, and then the third part is what we've learned about them. So, and then that handout should cover that. Should I show them the, I don't have the clue, but the cover, what the cover looks like? Now we'll just pass on that. So that's the first thing we'd like to announce is that we're writing a book. The team has finished the book. Any questions on that? Did you have one? That's enough. We pushed that enough. All right, moving into phase two. Phase two starting today. Phase two is actually called Operation Pooh Bear. Serious.
You and Slade, you came up with it. Come on, stand up. There's the guy who came up with the name. You thought you were kidding, didn't you?
So I wind up coming to Lance's house for the HoneyNet project, and of course, the HoneyNet logo is the Pooh Bear, and we come to his house, and he has a stuffed Pooh Bear on his front porch, Winnie the Pooh. So I'm like, okay, Operation Pooh Bear is the code name, and he's like, Operation Pooh Bar, and Foo Bar, and Foo Bear, and everything else, but yeah, so that's Pooh Bear.
So, that's the real name. That's RP, by the way. We got him suckered in the group, too. All right, now what is the mission? All about. Phase two is the same thing. We are dedicated to research. We always have been a research group, and we always will be a research group. We will never make money out of this. We'll lose money, but we'll never make money. What we're doing is focusing on learning the tools, tactics, and motives of the Black Hat community and sharing those lessons learned. The exact same mission statement we had for phase one. Our mission statement has not changed. What are our goals? We have two goals. One, information. The goal of information for phase two is to gather information on more sophisticated black hats and new attacks. We've gone after the kiddies. Let's up the ante and go over it. We want new clientele. That's the goal. Two, value. All right, all this stuff is fun. We saw IRC chats and stuff like that. Let's start deriving some serious value from our research. That is the second goal. How are we going to do that? Remember I told you, first goal, information. We want to gather more information. How are we going to do that? We're going to build improved honey nets. Dave Dietrich in a minute here is going to talk about second generation honey nets. Everything we told you so far, it's out of date. Second thing, multiple honey nets. We're going to distribute them around the world. Yes, all this information is great, but many of you are asking questions. You know, what about universities? What about, you know, e-commerce sites? The problem is all the data we had was based out of my spare bedroom. We're now going to distribute honey nets around the world, and we'll be discussing how we're going to do that. The other goal was value. We want to derive more value from it. First thing, early warning and prediction. Jeff Stutzman and Mike Kilger are going to show you how you can predict attacks based on gathering information from a honey net. They've already got proof of concept. They're going to be discussing that. The second thing we want to focus in on is identifying new or unknown tools. Yes, RPStatD is great. Yes, it's fun watching them hack it. But let's go ahead and start identifying new tools, new vulnerabilities, new exploits or tactics that are unknown. Like I said, we're going after a more sophisticated clientele. Let's check out how they do what they do. So that's what our goals are. And that's how we attempt to achieve it. Okay, now the plan, how are we going to achieve these goals? Yes, they sound wonderful. Okay, let's see you guys actually do it. Okay, this is where we're going to start handing it off to other members. But these are the steps we're taking to make phase two, to make RFPs Operation Pooh Bear happen. I don't know. All right, first of all, we're organizing as an official nonprofit organization. So all those companies out there that have been dying to give us millions of dollars in donations, you can now do it. We're nonprofit. Well, not yet. We've submitted the paperwork. The problem is when you want to be a nonprofit, it's got to go through the IRS. Yeah, so everything is in months. But that paperwork's already being written up and getting ready to be submitted. To be an official nonprofit organization, you literally have to have a board of directors. So we've already had two people volunteer and step up. George Kurtz, CEO of Foundstone, is the first one to volunteer, and Bruce Schneier is the second one. You're going to want to talk later? Yeah. George is going to tell us what the whole concept of the advisors of the board of directors are. So these guys are busy as hell guys, and they're stepping forward to volunteer their own time to help us out on this. Okay, now I'm going to go ahead and hand this off to Max. What we've done is... Hand this off to Matt.
Okay. Ah, yes, money. We noticed in the Federal Grant Register that they were looking for a grant under NIST, National Institute of Standards and Technology, looking to help protect critical infrastructure programs. He said, hey, well, that sort of sounds like what we want to do. We're going to go protect power plants and the FAA and our travel system and the rail system and et cetera and stuff like that. So. We sat down and said, okay, how are we going to do this? And a lot of late nights and writing and talking to people and budgets and a lot of government forms. We're really trying hard to get some money so that we can really expand it. The interesting thing about a honeypot or honey net is they're sensors. And sensors are really great. They're going to tell you what's ahead. When one gets knocked over, you're going to know what knocked it over. You'll be able to analyze it right away. I think it's really critical. Right now, out there, there really isn't much of anything that says, sort of like a NASDAQ or a New York Stock Exchange ticker that says, what's happening out there? What's the level of attacks? So things like that. And we really want to sort of spread some sensors out there so we can gather some data and do some statistical analysis and sort of say, well, what's the temperature today on the attack level? What's going on? And so a lot of folks spent a lot of late nights sort of writing this thing together and sent it off to the federal government, and we're now all on our knees praying that maybe we're going to get some money. Correct, sir?
Okay, Max was the lead in that. He helped us out. And the deal is we think our research can help the government in critical infrastructure, and we're hoping for some money. So we submitted for that. Okay, now I'm going to hand this off to Dave Dietrich. As many of you noticed, in the first generation honey nets, they had value. We were able to learn things, but there were some problems.
I'm not sure how I got voted leader of this. I asked Lance if Sun was giving him management training and he was practicing. It's either that or I can't say no to things.
Sucker.
So, well, okay, so people have been asking questions about some of the limitations in the current design of the honey net that we have. The slide's coming back up here with the diagram. We're using Checkpoint Firewall 1. It's set up in reverse so that all stuff comes in and only limited things go out. IDS sitting here monitoring both sides. And it's doing network address translation between that network block and whatever IP address he's using at the time.
thought is, how do you make this thing be something that's a little bit less visible? So if you try and take this picture and forget about the firewall and consider that box being a layer 2 device, OpenBSD filtering bridging mode, don't decrement TTLs so that you can't tell that that box is there. You can still do monitoring of the traffic in both directions. You can still do active response and turn things off. Now you can put this thing any place. You can use any network block. You can stick that machine. You can say this is a web farm. These are your, well, bad choice, but those are your web servers. You stick one in there that's not in the DNS rotary, for example. Stick this little device isolating it so that the only traffic that goes to that machine is traffic from somebody who found that machine. There's no production traffic going to it, so you don't have huge data that's coming through. You're not grabbing traffic with the snort sensors that you would then need to filter out or whatever. So this is now gonna isolate things, make it a little bit easier to just slap these things down any place. We're actually going to be adding some new methods of keystroke monitoring and system logging. We're looking at things like loadable kernel modules for both of those purposes. Also, with this design, we're able to do the same kinds of logging on the bridge, capturing all the traffic there.
K2's doing the kernel module development.
So some of the possibilities, I don't know if you guys saw the talk on worms Jose Nazario gave. In a situation like that where you've got some new kind of thing that goes out and starts hitting boxes, this would give you the ability to capture that traffic, get an early indication of something that's widespread. If these things are deployed all over universities or all over a bunch of different broadband and DSL networks, you now have some way of detecting things early, getting copies of whatever it is so you can start doing reverse engineering on it. I also mentioned that this isolates the honey pots from production traffic. You don't have as many of those issues of trying to weed out things. And it's going to allow you to do things like capture new attacks. If you consider this to be something to augment your intrusion detection systems, if Snort doesn't catch something because there are no signatures for it, you can go ahead and do the reverse engineering, figure out what it is.
That's it.
Questions? Well, actually, the big thing there on what Dave's basically covering is instead of a layer 3 firewall, we're going to a layer 2 firewall. We're going to have some more advanced functionality of controlling the packets. Oh, okay.
Okay, so the concept is trying to get distributed sensors. I didn't mention that part. We're going to be using IPsec VPNs between all of these sensor machines, feeding all the data to a collector that will then do the analysis. So doing this, and there's one other, I guess, detail I didn't mention. The filtering bridge is using two Ethernet interfaces. Stick a third Ethernet interface on the box to manage. That can be on a completely different network block than the one that you are logging traffic for. So it's not going to be as easy for somebody to find this thing and attack it. Much more stealthy, and data collection is going to go to a central place where we can do all of the monitoring much faster and easier.
One of the other areas we're doing is there's some development in a tool called Hogwash with Snort. So what happens also, too, is what you see here is this the first generation. The firewall allowed 5 connections, initiated connection, go outbound and then blocked anymore. One of the ideas that Dave came up with is not only are we using a layer 2 firewall, but the layer 2 firewall, since the packets are going through the bridge, can change packets, can drop a couple packets, allow certain packets to go, so we have far greater control of what packets go through the firewall. So instead of blocking a connection, we can make it look like network latency, we can change the packets, it's our world, we can create it, we can do whatever we want with it, and yet the bad guy is we've limited the detection capability by going to a layer 2 firewall because there is no IP stack, there is no TTL decrement, there is nothing to attack. Any questions on that? Okay, we'll go on. Okay, something that's really exciting. Let's see here. One of the ways we want to gather value on that stuff, too, is what we call early warning and prediction. And Jeff Stutzman's taking the lead on this, but also Max Kilger's on this. The premise being is we can tell when the bad guys are going to attack days ahead of time before it happens. And they've got the information to prove it.
I'm going to kick this off and then let Max finish it up. But basically, the one good thing about the honey net that we've talked about over and over and over here is that there's no false positives. Everything is real. People are there. They're there for a reason. And so in my past life, I was a Navy intelligence officer. And actually, I am on paper until the 1st of August. But I work for Cisco. I'm on permanent vacation now. So that was really cool to be able to dig into data and kind of take this kind of information and say, there are no false positives here. One of the things that everybody's interested in is early warning. How can you predict this stuff? So I'm gonna preface all of this by saying, first of all, that the HoneyNet data is really a nano sample. We're talking about, I tested over 10 attacks, and we came out okay in those, and we're gonna work on some bigger stuff. And I'm not a statistician. I'm a liberal arts kind of guy with, just about finished with an MBA. So these guys are the geeks, and I'm not the geek. But anyway, going through the MBA program, let me back up a little bit. For about the last year, I've been working part-time with Carnegie Mellon on trying to figure out different models for doing predictions and indications and warning. And you know what? I thought my head was going to explode. Because there are so many freaking ways of doing business, and there are so many inflections that come in, waiting stuff and all this. So just before I got out of the Navy, I stopped doing that, and my head cleared out, and I kind of started focusing on finishing the semester with the night courses. And my last semester was operations management. And one of the things that they talk about in operations management is a process called statistical process control. And what that really boils down to is, let's find a way of measuring defects off a factory floor. So it's funny because Jay and I were just having the same conversation. Jay used to work in a factory as a coder and would measure the defects and did statistical process control and could tell when things were going to go bad and actually could predict it. So I said, well, geez, I wonder if this would work on the HoneyNet data. Let's pull the old data. And one good thing about the way the data is organized within the internal group is that you don't get the answers unless you go looking for them. So I had all of the snort detects and I had all the firewall stuff, but I didn't have the answers yet. So I wasn't able to cheat when I went through and did the work. But basically what I did was I took all of the snort logs over a 9-month period. And for each month individually, I broke out the top 10 or 15 rules that were reported out. And then I counted them up, just counted them every day for the 30 days or 31 days in the month. And then what I did is I created a 3-day moving average, just like you see in a stock market chart. Every day the ticker, it gives you the 3-day moving average. Helps to predict whether the movement's going to go up or down. I took a 2 standard deviation control. Can I throw the picture up there? The picture's a whole lot easier to look at than the numbers.
The blind depth?
Yeah. Let's just show that one.
This one?
You got the one with the RPC? There you go. That's a good one. Okay. So what I did was, this was over 180 days. I took the counts of those snort rules. And then for the entire period, I took an average and I took a standard deviation. Just real simple. I wanted to set some control limits above and below for the amount of activity that was happening every day. In a manufacturing facility, typically they would try for either a 2 or a 3-day standard or a 2 or 3 standard deviation control, and if something happened here, if you saw a run in the data that went above the control limits, you knew that you had too many defects and you had to fix it. So there are a couple of things that you would look for. You would either look for something going out of bounds above the control limits, or you would look for a run in the numbers, and a run might be 3 increases, something like that. So that's where the 3-day moving average came in. Now, when I was doing this, I first sent the spreadsheet to Lance, and he said, get this out of here, because I'm not a statistician, and I don't even want to hear it. But, you know, picture tells 1,000 words. So this was actually pretty cool, because right here, we showed activity. And guess where the hack was? Right there. And then we came down here, and I think, Max, you told me I missed one in here, right? It was like right in here someplace. I missed the spike. Actually, it was right here, but I didn't draw any attack. And then this was the same thing where I saw the spike. And this was by far the longest notice I had. Out of 10 intrusions at the honey net, every single one of them had a three-day notice, except for that one that had seven. So that's pretty interesting. Now, again, this is on a nano sample. This is on 10 attacks over a 9 or 10-month period, I think. When you go through the November scan of the month, November was chosen because it's really juicy. Several operating systems represented. We gave you the dates that they were placed online, so you really get to see how this stuff works. And if you come up with a better way of doing it, I'd love to know, because it's just cool stuff. Did I hit everything? Well, I guess what I should say is, what was really cool about it was I did it one way and then kicked it to Max. And Max verified it through a whole nother methodology and came up with the same results. So the bottom line here is, in a nano sample, it works very well. It's very accurate. Now, I've got a Linux box in my office at Cisco now that's going to have 100 gigs of IDS data loaded on. I've tested this in a 30 gig data set, and it worked just fine there too. But not enough to the point where I want to be able to go out and publish on it and say, you know, in an enterprise, this works. We haven't tested it that far yet. But in a 30 gig sample, we did see the spikes. Now, what I would do in a larger enterprise network, just to extrapolate this out a little bit further, is say, instead of using the actual numbers, I would change this to an index, run it across, and then you compare apples to apples. And you would take the standard deviation on the index, compare it to each individual sensor, and you could tell when that sensor was going to be attacked. So what would end up happening is, if you had 30 sensors out there and you see this kind of a run going above your control limits on the individual sensor, at least you know now you need to start paying attention. Go one step further beyond that, and we talked a few minutes ago about hackers having terrible OPSEC. So maybe at that point you need to start doing more attention. Maybe you can start doing correlations to IP addresses and things like that, help you even get a little bit closer. They're everything. It's whatever came out of the snort. Some of them were probes, some of them were attempted intrusions. And then what I did is Lance keeps just a running flat file with just the dates of the intrusions and what it was. And that's the one that I plotted out here. And that's really when he gave me a little bit of credibility. So.
What do you use to process all the snort data?
Excel. Sorry.
Just one comment. There's a CSV output plugin for Snort now, where you can have Snort actually put out to CSV formatted files if you want to import the stuff into Excel or whatever you want. So that's available. Plus, you know, there's all the database stuff too. If you have binary Snort logs, you can rerun them through Snort in its readback mode and replay the data into the database, so you can do database queries on the data and stuff like that. I wasn't consulted on this particular thing.
Statistics, close to my heart. I used to teach statistics at the undergrad and graduate level in the social science departments. As you can see, here's my 20-year-old HP calculator, which I still hold near and dear to my heart. I was in a class where it was half calculators and half slide rules. I'm going, this thing is now worth more now than it was when I bought it. So if I ever lose this sucker, it breaks, I'm in trouble. Let me real quickly just sort of show you what we got going here. Here we go. Yeah. Oops, wrong. Then we want to show that first. Here we go. In the beginning, there was a tiny light. This is really sort of very alpha level analysis. We're sort of on the fly trying to do this. Let's just try and produce a real simple predictive model without worrying too much about statistical significance tests and assumptions for the moment. So let's just, what I did is took the snort rule reports or violation reports, the frequency of them, and regressed them against days to the box got whacked. And let's sort of take a look at the chart. You can sort of see, oops, same slide. Oh, all right, next slide. Here we go. Regression model predicted days until whacking. Right here, this huge dip right here. Any dip is a bad sign. That means there are a lot of triggers going off. Here at about day 60 or so, at day 68 is where it got nailed. So we had about 7 days or so worth of warning. Once again, over here, we have three other spikes. The machine got whacked at day 178, and there's one here at about 177, one back here at about 170. And then this one I'm not really sure about. It could be the same thing. You just say, hey, it's coming. It's sort of hard to say, to connect it directly since it's not quite so close. But still, that's really cool. Here we have some predictive warning that you're going to get bagged. When you see these drops like that, something's coming your way. Right. Right. And I'm still a little puzzled about this. Somebody sort of suggested, well, that's where the system is going to go to Tahiti because nothing bad's going to happen. But I'm not so sure about that. So anyway, give it back to Lance.
So in a nutshell, for us non-statisticians like me who didn't understand half of that, because I took statistics in graduate school, the only reason I passed is my wife was in the class with me. That's why I married her. No. What these guys are saying is they've proven that they can 3 days out warning, and this is part of our critical infrastructure plan. When we submitted for NIST funding, we're telling the government, if you put these sensors out, you have this information. Nice thing about HoneyNets is there's no false positives. Everything in there is real. It's bad guys. You can use that information, potentially predict future attacks. We're going to be releasing a paper called Know Your Enemy Statistics, where these guys show their information, and we're going to release the 9 months of data. And we've got nothing to hide. That's the nice thing about the HoneyNet project, and there's nothing to protect. So you guys can go ahead and test it yourself. Okay, yeah, and then Tim, you had a question. Was that for these guys?
Yeah, there was actually only one where I had picked it up beyond 3 days, and that was that last RPC with the arrow that I showed down. Yeah, there was actually one case where I had seen, it was a Solaris box that was put up where we saw the activity ahead of time, and then the second one, there was really no warning. It just came up, and boom, they went back with the same StatD overflow and got it. So that was the one that I'd missed out on.
Absolutely correct. I have some more slides that actually statistically show that. I did a time series ARIMA model where it shows whether it's scanning and they sort of go away and then they come back. It actually statistically, there's evidence to show exactly what you just said.
One of the nice things about the way that Max had done business as well was he actually proved that the three-day moving average was probably a little bit too long, that 2 days is really accurate, and at 4 days it's gone. It's completely too far. So this was a shot in the dark at a baseline sensitivity.
To restate the obvious, this is a case of people looking for targets of opportunity, indiscriminate attacks.
And that's not to say that this is a kind of attack that you're always going to see, the kind of attack methodology. I've seen a number of tools lately that basically wrap everything together. They're scanning. When they find one that's vulnerable, they hit it, they rootkit it, they install crap on it, they go on to the next one. So you're not going to get any warning on some of them.
Keep in mind, we're not saying, ha, we've discovered the solution. It's, ha, we have this crazy idea we want to continue our research on. That's...
I'd love this one. I read a sociological paper that dealt with one of these worldwide MUDs where as the sun rose and set in different parts of the world, I forget the name of the MUD, but different gangs of kids from different countries would come on and rule the mud, and then you know, there were lulls as the sun progressed across the Pacific and Atlantic, and then the exact cycle would start again. It's pretty fabulous.
Yeah. And the one other thing too is, you know, scans a day at night and stuff like that. The problem you have is, you know, it might be night when Korea's scanning you, and then they scan you, but then all the other countries are scanning you too. So you're getting hammered day and night. It's just, you know, it doesn't, the people I always, ISS is awesome at this. ISS goes, it's 3 a.m, and you see this guy attempting to log in, and nobody ever logs in at 3 a.m. Well, I got news for you. 2 p.m, somebody's trying to hack you too. Because at 2 p.m, it's probably 3 a.m. somewhere else. So, but my, yeah, it's actually definitely a. So, the one thing I want to say is, though, is when you're going through your own system logs, you know, it doesn't matter if the hackers always attack at night. Well, that's fine, but, you know, during the day, it's night somewhere else. So it can always happen. All right, hold on here. Go ahead. What's that?
Well, I was just wondering, for the
lily pad, whatever you want to call them, and I can track that certain time frame over time, then yeah, I can make those kinds of assumptions. And here's a good example. There was a particular site, okay, that was getting hit a lot. And what we did is went back and did this kind of work, and what we found were that this I don't know if it was one hacker or how many it was, but what we basically found was that there was an exact time phase shift between the time we would see the scan and the time we would see the probes. Okay, scans being network-wide, probes being individual machines. So what we saw was that the scans were coming through the TIN network in Italy, and they were coming through, it was a Canadian net, but I don't remember the name of it. And then what we would see is the time phase, it was exact 12-hour time shift, and we would see probes coming from Korea and from the UK. So I'm not sure if that answers your question, but yeah, those kinds of patterns do jump out, and you can use those to profile.
Keep in mind, we're releasing a paper on this research, so if you didn't quite get it all, or if there's some more questions, the paper's not only going to answer all these questions, but hey, here's the 9 months of data. You can figure it out and prove it if you want. Go ahead. Okay. What we're going to do now is shift gears from the statistics and continue on. Do you have any more questions about statistics? Afterwards, Pete, the stats we need up. We're starting to, now like you said, remember, one of the things we wanted to do is deploy distributed HoneyNets. Our goal in the next 2 years is for the HoneyNet project to start distributing them, but we also want to set up work with other organizations. Maybe they have better ways of setting up HoneyNets. Here's just an example of two organizations, University of Penn. They've already got a HoneyNet set up. I think they're using Linux firewall with IP tables. Naval Postgrad Program, that's what Rob's working on and stuff like that. Other organizations, too, are setting up HoneyNets for the research purposes. So we're sharing their data, and we're also sharing ideas, exchanging ideas of maybe better ways of setting up HoneyNets. So if you're interested in maybe setting up a HoneyNet for research purposes and you want to work with us, come up and talk with anybody here. And like I said, we're going to continue to share everything we learn. We're going to continue the Know Your Enemy series of papers. Scan of the month, we're going to attempt to continue that, depending on how much time we have. I know Dave Dietrich is dying to do another forensics challenge. Yeah.
And if you don't GPL your data, we will not help you.
Everything we're doing is open source. One of the things we really want to do is if we get some funding, if we get the NIST funding, is we want to pay people to develop software. Because, you know, a lot of times they'll be like, hey, K2, can you develop a kernel module that does this or that? And the poor kid's busy as hell, and it takes a lot of time. You know, busy as hell doing what? He's busy writing rootkits. But no, the deal is we think it'd be great to pay people to develop code for us and then release it to the community. I mean, it would be great to have, you know, snort modules that do passive fingerprinting or grab information or things like that. And then we pay people to do it, but it would all be GPL'd. I mean, they would get all the you know, their name and stuff like that. But our results, our work, our money would benefit not only us but the community. So that's where we want to go. Everything, our idea is to share everything we do, and it's all going to be open source. Okay, to wrap up this presentation, we continue to dedicate the research to the Black Hat community. We're a research group. We're not out to sell anything. I mean, look, we're going nonprofit. There's no way we can make any money off this. And it's our goal for this research to go ahead for the benefit and the development of the security community. I think that's it. Here's the resources. Did you want to see it? This is Monsieur George Kurtz.
I just wanted to take a minute and give you a few thoughts on the HoneyNet project. It's certainly a pleasure for me to be involved in the HoneyNet project and to work with a fine group of outstanding citizens that we have sitting up here. And if you've been to the Shadow Bar at all, you'll realize how much beer this group actually drinks. So my job as a board of director is to actually allocate the beer fund so that all of the money that we get doesn't actually get spent. So that's my primary goal. In reality, though, it's a pleasure to help out. Anything I can do on the funding side, I think I will in trying to tap some resources. I also think the predictive nature and the data that's going to come out of this will be very valuable for individuals and organizations and corporations, and any way that we can help formulate the data so that it's actually useful in predicting these sort of attacks, I think is going to be very important. So overall, I'm looking forward to working with these folks, which I have in the past, and I'm sure that you will see some continued good results from them, and hopefully support the efforts as those mechanisms and vehicles become available. Thanks.
There's no way that Lance is going to say this, so I'm going to say it on behalf of all the HoneyNet members, that without Lance's hunting for a word, ridiculous enthusiasm, this would not certainly have been possible, and I think Lance deserves a lot of credit. He does a lot for the community.
So if you ask one of us a question, you're asking all of us a question. Feel free to beat anybody up. Thanks.